This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London.
Welcome to this. This is the 15th annual Virginia Woolf Birthday Lecture, and it's on this very day this year, which is her, would be her 132nd birthday. Before we start, could I just ask you to make sure that your mobile phones are switched to silent, please? And please don't take any photographs during the lecture. This year we are the guests of the Institute of English Studies here at the University of London. And for the first time we have opened up this special event to non-members of the Society. The Virginia Woolf Society of Great Britain extends an especially warm welcome to you, and we hope it will inspire you to join. And to tempt you further. We have special membership rates for today only, so please see Sarah at the back after the lecture. We also have some of the Society's publications for sale, including previous year's birthday lectures. It's a very great privilege to introduce you to our birthday lecturer this afternoon. For over 30 years, Professor Dame Hermione Lee has been a highly influential figure in English literature studies, particularly for those of us whose interest centres on Virginia Woolf. She published a book-length study of the novels in 1977, but it is for her tremendous biography of Woolf, published in 1996, for which we continue to be grateful. Despite the number of biographies of Woolf published in the 80s and 90s alone, the Financial Times had the sense to name it one of the most impressive biographies of the decade, and 18 years later, it remains deservedly in print to prove it. She has written Introductions to the Years, To the Lighthouse, A Room of One's Own, Three Guineas, On Being Ill, and The Hogarth Letters, as well as countless essays and reviews, including one famously named Virginia Woolf's Nose. Hermione was a special guest of the Society's 10 years ago at the unveiling of the memorial to Virginia Woolf in Tavistock Square. And in 2012, she gave the Leslie Stephen Lecture at Cambridge, just as Lytton Strachey and Desmond McCarthy had done many years earlier. Of course, she has also written widely on other literary subjects, away from Bloomsbury, including Elizabeth Bowen and Edith Wharton. And last year saw the publication of this, her latest biography, Penelope Fitzgerald, A Life. And she's excited by the project. She's general editor of a reissue of all Penelope Fitzgerald's work, published by HarperCollins. From 1998 to 2008, Hermione was the Goldsmiths Chair of English Literature and Fellow of New College at the University of Oxford. And in 2008, she was elected president of Wolfson College, Oxford. The title of her lecture this afternoon is To Pin Down the Moment. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Professor Dame Hermione Lee.
Thank you very much. There is a handout. Did you get it on your seat? Everyone's nodding. And if you didn't get it, I'm hoping there is some more at the back. I'm not sure about that. But anyway, if you share if you haven't got one of your own. Okay, so thank you very much, and it's very good to be here. As we now know, today is Virginia Woolf's 132nd birthday. And to mark the moment, I've chosen to start with a very well-known quotation from A Room of One's Own, which is itself nearly 85 years old. I am sure you will all know it. It comes in the context of her discussion of the challenge that the new woman novelist, call her Mary Carmichael, will have to face in using her particular creative powers to say what happens when a woman goes into a room, and how that woman novelist will need to get away from the male novelist's representation of women, which mainly seems to consist, as Woolf teasingly puts it, of the courtesan, the harlot, and the lady with the pug dog. So this is the passage, and it's the first one on the handout. However, The majority of women are neither harlots nor courtesans, nor do they sit clasping pug dogs to dusty velvet all through the summer afternoon. But what do they do then? And there came to my mind's eye one of those long streets somewhere south of the river, whose infinite rows are innumerably populated. With the eye of the imagination, I saw a very ancient lady crossing the street on the arm of a middle-aged woman, her daughter perhaps, both so respectably booted and furred that their dressing in the afternoon must be a ritual, and the clothes themselves put away in cupboards with camphor year after year throughout the summer months. They cross the road when the lamps are being lit, for the dusk is their favourite hour, as they must have done year after year. The elder is close on 80, but if one asked her what her life has meant to her, she would say that she remembered the streets lit for the Battle of Balaclava, or had heard the guns fire in Hyde Park for the birth of King Edward VII. And if one asked her, longing to pin down the moment with date and season, but what were you doing on the 5th of April 1868, or the 2nd of November 1875, she would look vague and say that she could remember nothing, for all the dinners are cooked, the plates and cups washed, the children sent to school and gone out into the world. Nothing remains of it all. All has vanished. No biography or history has a word to say about it. And the novels, without meaning to, inevitably lie. All these infinitely obscure lives remain to be recorded. The passage is often cited when her commitment to obscure lives, her feminism, her sense of history, or her attitude to life writing are being discussed. But what I want to concentrate on today is her use of those dates. And if one asked her, longing to pin down the moment with date and season, but what were you doing on the 5th of April 1868 or the 2nd of November 1875? Part of the point of the imaginary scene, and it's one of many such telling imaginary street encounters in a room of one's own, is that you can't pin down the moment with date and season, because these obscure lives of women, cooking the dinners, washing the plates and cups, sending the children out into the world, are by their nature repetitive and unmarked. They don't produce the kind of major events in the history of great men that Jacob Flanders was studying a few years earlier, of which the examples here are the Battle of Balaclava and the birth of King Edward VII. Repeatedly, all through her work, Virginia Woolf presents another kind of history-making and life-writing and another way of thinking about time than is formulated by chronologies of major events or lists of public acts or trajectories of recognised male achievements, as in the Dictionary of National Biography. But she is also very concerned with pinning down the moment and with date and season. So I want to look today at the way she marks some dates and seasons repeatedly, even obsessively, as a way of remembering her own life, making sense of the past, and thinking about or dealing with age and death. It may be a kind of joke to imagine asking those two old ladies what they were doing on the 5th of April 1868 or the 2nd of November 1875. They're actually random dates. If you Google those dates, you can't, but I think there was an obscure volcanic eruption, but nothing of any great historical importance actually happened on either of those dates. But when it comes to marking her own life, Virginia Woolf does need to remember what she was doing on days of great significance in her private calendar, such as the 5th of May 1895 or the 10th of August 1912. Exact dates matter very much to her, just as it matters to her, as she says so eloquently in her sketch of the past, to salvage the moments of being from the nondescript cotton wool of the many more moments of non-being that fill most of our days. When in Sketch of the Past she goes back to excavate those moments of her life, both painful and pleasurable, that she's experienced most intensely, so intensely that she thinks of them still as still possibly in existence, she imagines a device yet to be invented, a kind of time-travelling tape recorder, which will enable her to tap into those moments, to, as she puts it, turn up August 1890. It's absolutely typical of her that this fantasy of time travel should be fixed by a particular date and season. That longing to pin down the moment with date and season is a feature of many of the novels. As critics and readers of Woolf have increasingly emphasised, her modernist strategies of impressionism, time shifts, language experiments, and infiltration of consciousness should not lead us to overlook her historical precision and her interest in specific dates. There's an excellent book by Bryony Randall called Modernism, Daily Time and Everyday Life, published by CUP in 2007, which deals with modernist writers' strategies for transforming the everydayness of present time. And it makes much of Virginia Woolf's fondness for what Randall calls the one-day novel, for putting her whole life into a single day full of memory and repetition. Mrs. Dalloway is obviously the most famous example of this, set on a particular, if imaginary, Wednesday in June 1923, with the clock striking the time all the way through the book. As David Bradshaw, a previous lecturer at this, one of these events, as David Bradshaw in his edition of Mrs. Dalloway has nicely proved by looking at the details of the cricket match that's mentioned in that novel between Surrey and Yorkshire. He works out that it's actually an imaginary Wednesday, not the 13th of June or the 20th of June, as some other critics have supposed. Two single summer days, undated but clearly pre-war and post-war, provide the two wings of the triptych of To the Lighthouse. A single, though unspecified, summer day emphatically frames the lives of the six characters in The Waves. All the action between the acts takes place through the 24 hours of a summer night, day and night in June 1939. And there's a series of references in the novel to a June day in 1939. I think it must be a Saturday because there's a fish delivery in the morning, a commuter's train from London at lunchtime, a second post delivery, and a pageant in the afternoon. So the novel, if your interest tends that way, could be dated as the 3rd, the 10th, the 17th, or the 24th of June, 1939. Most teasingly specific, Orlando ends on the 12th stroke of midnight, the last minute of Thursday, the 11th of October, 1928, which is the date of the novel's publication. You could even argue, as James Hafley did in his book The Glass Roof, that Orlando is a one-day novel set on that date, and that from it are projected back into space the 300 years of its first five chapters. Even when her novels don't use the one-day strategy, they want to pin down date and season. The date of the voyage out can be identified as 1910 by historical references in the novel, including those to a general election featuring the Liberal Prime Minister Herbert Asquith and to the Woman's Suffrage Bill. A Sunday evening in October sets the tone in the first sentence of Night and Day, when Catherine Hilbery is pouring tea, like many other young women of her class and time. Later, a reference to the insurance bill implies that the year is 1911. Winter weather, moving into early spring, dominates the whole of Night and Day. In the last paragraph only, when the lovers finally make themselves understood, there is a vision of nightingales in June. Jacob's Room starts on the 3rd of September, with no date. But Jacob goes up to Cambridge in October 1906, presumably at the age of 18. And though no other dates are given in the book, it's possible to trace the timescale of the book through to 1914. Specific dates from 1880 to the present date of 1937, the present day of 1937, though with disconcerting gaps between them, mark the action of the years. So time, place, memory, thoughts may shift about with the utmost adventurousness within her novels, but date and season can very often be pinned down. When Virginia Woolf famously observes in her essay of 1924, Character and Fiction, that on or about December 1910, human character changed, she's not only alluding to the death of Edward VII, the post-impressionist exhibition, the campaign for votes for women, and the dreadnought hoax, all of which took place in that year. She's also indulging her desire to pin down the historical moment with date and season. When I was writing A Life of Woolf, it struck me forcibly, reading and rereading her diaries, how often she marks her own life by returning to or dwelling on particular dates that are of significance to her. Many, though not all of these, are deaths. Her mother's death, Stella Duckworth's death, her brother Toby's death, and later the deaths of Catherine Mansfield, Jacques Ravarat, Lytton Strachey, Julian Bell, and Roger Fry. Some are birthdays, Leslie's, Toby's, her own. Some are anniversaries, Stella's engagement, her and Leonard's marriage, Vanessa and Clive's marriage. Some are summings up of the year just passed, which she often does at the end of a diary volume. Of course, there's nothing unusual about this. We all do this. We all call to mind key dates in our lives with strong and mixed emotions. We all like to mark major events and dates and moments that matter to us. But not all of us write and rewrite them to an even ritualistic extent. Imaginative writers, particularly those who think a great deal about mortality, like Keats, or those with meticulous and melancholy habits of mind, like Lewis Carroll or Thomas Hardy, do this to a marked degree. Keats, according to his recent biographer Nicholas Rowe, constantly reverted to the dates of his father's death and funeral. Thomas Hardy's memoranda are full of lists of dates of deaths. Charles Dodgson would mark his good days, as the Romans did, with a white stone in his diaries. And I would be very interested to hear other examples of this sort of obsessive marking of dates. The most obvious and poignant example of Woolf's desire to pin down the dates of her past is her return to the date of her mother's death on May the 5th, 1895, when she was 13 and her mother was 49. You could call it the day on which her childhood ended, and it was certainly the day in which her obsession with her dead mother began. Her returns to this day are found too in fictional form, Into the Lighthouse and The Years, and also when she's thinking about other people's deaths. She cannot let it rest. There are three returns to this date in her diaries, two of them on or near its anniversary, and there's one in Sketch of the Past. When she writes these returns, she is at pains to pin down the number of years since the date. So the next quote on your sheet. Monday, 5th of May, 1924. This is the 29th anniversary of Mother's death. I think it happened early on a Sunday morning, and I looked out of the nursery window and saw old Dr. Seaton walking away with his hands behind his back, as if to say, it is finished. And then the doves descending to peck in the road, I suppose, with a fall and descent of infinite peace. I was 13 and could fill a whole page and more with my impressions of that day, many of them ill-received by me and hidden from the grown-ups, but very memorable on that account. How I laughed, for instance, behind the hand which was meant to hide my tears, and through the fingers saw the nurses sobbing. But enough of death. It's life that matters. The memory recurred, too, when she hears of Roger Fry's death in September 1934. Wednesday, the 12th of September 1934. I remember turning aside at Mother's bed when she had died and Stella took us in, to laugh secretly at the nurse crying. She's pretending, I said, age 13, and was afraid I was not feeling enough. So now. A few years later, in 1937, she returns to the moment again, dating her diary entry wrongly and tellingly, Tuesday the 5th of May, 1937, when actually the day was Tuesday the 4th of May. Tuesday the 4th of May, 1937. The day Mother died in 1895, that 37 minus 95 equals 42 years ago. And I remember it, at the moment, watching Dr. Seaton walk away up Hyde Park Gate in the early morning with his head bowed, his hands behind his back. Also the doves swooping. We had been sent up to the day nursery after she died and were crying. And I went to the open window and looked out. It must have been very soon after she died, as Seaton was then leaving the house. How that early morning picture has stayed with me. What happened immediately afterwards, I can't remember. The inability to feel, the nurse weeping, the looking out of the window, are used in the mother's deathbed scene in The Years in 1937. And she comes back to it again in Sketch of the Past in 1939, where her strategy is to seesaw between the platform of present time on which I stand and to find consolation from that period by going back to a matching moment in past time. So writing in May 1939 in Sketch of the Past, she says, I turn for a few days' respite to May 1895. In Sketch of the Past, again, she expands on all those key ingredients in the scene, the pigeons floating and settling, the doctor walking away, the beauty of the morning, Stella looking after her, the inability to feel, the nurse crying, and she writes it all at much greater length. Again, she is at pains to pin down the exact expanse of time between the event and the return to, quote, all that I felt on May the 5th, 1895, now almost exactly to a day, 44 years ago, when my mother died. That Sketch of the Past. That little sum of years jotted onto the page in the 1937 diary entry I've given you, of which the total is the gap of time between the remembered event and the present, is a frequent device of hers. She's adding up her life, making a sum of it. When she thinks of her dead, she sets their pastness against the future present of her own life. It confirms the shock of recognizing how long past they have become. But marking the distance in time between her adult self and her lost dead can also be a form of consolation. Here's an especially powerful calculation of such a time gap. It's the next sheet on your handout. Wednesday, 28th of November, 1928, Father's birthday. He would have been 1928 minus 1832, 96. 96, yes, today, and could have been 96, like other people one has known, but mercifully was not. His life would have entirely ended mine. What would have happened? No writing, no books, inconceivable. What would have happened to her own life if the long dead person had gone on living? It's a very startling calculation, I think. She does the same thing more longingly with Toby, who died in 1906, aged 26, and who is in her mind more than ever in 1929 and 1930 while she's writing The Waves. Two diary entries bring him back to life. One is a record of talking to Clive Bell at Christmas in 1929 and thinking, as always, how their relationship is shadowed by the ghost of Toby, that queer ghost. I think of death sometimes as the end of an excursion which I went on when he died, as if I should come in and say, well, here you are. And again, writing when going back to her diary after a few days' illness in September 1930, she makes another of her calculations. How old would he be now? Monday, 8th of September 1930. I will signalise my return to life, that is, writing, by beginning a new book. And it happens to be Toby's birthday, I remark. He would have been, I think, 50 today. She's metaphorically returning to life by resuming her writing after illness, and she's also returning her brother to the life he might have had. Such returns to key dates of her past are frequent in the diaries, but much less common in the letters, where she is, on the whole, much more taken up with the present. There are exceptions, though, like her exchanges about her parents with Vanessa when Vanessa's reading to the lighthouse, or her thoughts about her father on his 100th anniversary in 1932, or her occasional touching mentions of Toby as to their friend Saxon Sidney Turner on 24th of November 1916, almost exactly 10 years after Toby's death on 20th of November 1906. She writes to Saxon, "His death meant almost more to you and me than anyone. Often I've known that we both kept him with us, though we did not talk of him." Not all her notations of past events are of deaths. Stella Duckworth's engagement to Jack Hills, which remained inviolate in her memory because Stella died so soon after the marriage, always stayed in her mind. She calculates its distance from her in the diary for Tuesday, the 22nd of August, 1922, describing the scene of Jack Hills proposing to Stella in the garden of a house in Hazelmere, which the Stevens had borrowed for a summer holiday in the gloomy period after Juliet's death. It's a scene she often returns to because it seems fixed in a glow of unchanging romance. But as quite often when she makes her calculations of date and time, she's got the date actually slightly wrong. It happened in 1896, not 1897. It's the next quote. Tuesday, 22nd of August, 1922. On this day, I don't know how many years ago, 1897 to be precise, Jack came to Hindhead and was accepted by Stella in the Moonlight Garden. We wandered about the house till she came in and told us Jack was accepted. 1922 minus 1897, 25 years ago. As she died so soon after, somehow it still seems to me like a real thing, unsmothered by the succeeding years. Some other engagements she would prefer not to think back to. So in the diary for February the 7th, 1923, she writes dryly, thinking of her sister's marriage to Clive Bell 16 years before, which caused her such pain, "Nessa's wedding day, reflections suppressed." The time gap from her own wedding anniversary is more tenderly calculated, as on the 11th of April, 1931. It's the next quote. 11th of April, 1931. After being married since August 1912, 1931 minus 1912, 19 years. How moving to find this warmth, curiosity, attachment in being alone with L. Of course, one day she often marks is this day, January the 25th. In the letters, she doesn't make much of her birthday, though there is the occasional fond reprimand to Vanessa for having given her a present for her 55th, for instance, when present giving was supposed to be forbidden. This present must have arrived in a very large round bag, because at first she thought the present was a kitten in a basket, but it turned out to be a teapot, the perfect teapot. And thanking her, she says, "The problem of teapots is forever solved." And there's a dry note to Quentin on January the 24th, 1934, the day before her 52nd birthday, after attending Ethel Smy's huge and ghastly 75th birthday with hundreds of people and terrible jokes by Sir Thomas Beecham. She says to Quentin, "When I am 75, dearest Quentin, please restrain your kind feelings and do not give me a lunch party at the Grosvenor Hotel." In the diaries, however, she often marks her birthdays. There's a vivid description in 1915 of her 33rd birthday, written in Richmond in wartime, only a few weeks before the onset of a long period of serious mental illness and breakdown. It's a touching and troubling entry, and not only because one knows what's about to happen. She writes not as if she's a married woman in her 30s, but as if she's a small child under protection, and she is also at the same time thinking about her childhood, almost reverting to it. Monday, 25th of January, 1915. It's on the sheet. "My birthday. And let me count up all the things I had. L had sworn he would give me nothing, and like a good wife, I believed him, but he crept into my bed with a little parcel, which was a beautiful green purse, and he brought up breakfast with a paper which announced a naval victory. We have sunk a German battleship, and a square brown parcel with the abbot in it, a lovely first edition. So I had a very merry and pleasing morning. I was then taken up to town, free of charge, and given a treat, first at the picture palace and then at Buzzard's. I don't think I've had a birthday treat for 10 years. I don't know when I've enjoyed a birthday so much. Not since I was a child, anyhow. I was also given a packet of sweets to take home." 5 years on, a later birthday, her 38th, is an occasion for a more independent and confident kind of celebration. Her realization of how she will write her next novel, Jacob's Room. But it also involves thinking back to earlier birthdays. Monday, 26th of January, 1920. This one's not on your sheet, sorry. "The day after my birthday. In fact, I'm 38. Well, I've no doubt I'm a great deal happier than I was at 28. And happier today than I was yesterday, having this afternoon arrived at some idea of a new form for a new novel." That's a birthday. Here, the advantage of being 38 over 28 is calculated as a bonus, a sum of addition. Bryony Randall's book calls attention to how characters in Woolf's novels talk about their ages, the numbers of their days, as if they are counters being moved from one pile in the future or in the past. So Ginny in The Wave says she has 50 years, 60 years to spend. I have not yet broken into my hoard. Clarissa Dalloway is described as having just broken into her 52nd year. Months and months of it were still untouched. Randall notes in this what she calls this arithmetic of dailiness, an ambivalence as to whether days add or subtract. Is there increase, stasis, or diminution? It's a nice question. Virginia Woolf's 50th birthday in 1932 ought to have been an occasion to mark, either for loss or gain. She anticipates it with mixed feelings, asking herself how long their lives, hers and Leonard's, might last. It's one of the diary entries in which she tops up her potential lifespan, very poignant for us to read. Wednesday, 13th of January, 1932. How long will they be? Can we count on another 20 years? I shall be 50 on the 25th, Monday week, that is, and sometimes feel that I have lived 250 years already, and sometimes that I am still the youngest person in the omnibus. And I want to write another 4 novels. This is a programme to last out my 20 years if I have them. But a week after that entry, Lytton Strachey died on the 21st of January, very close to her 50th birthday, and after that she hardly mentions her birthdays. Yet occasionally, even in dark times, the birthday will still be a marker not for despondency, but for hopefulness and possibility. 7 years later, she makes a similar calculation, as in 1932, about how long she might have left. Tuesday, 24th of January, 1939, the eve of my 57th birthday. And on the bus, coming back from the flower show, I describe my new novel, and we planned the books we should write, if we could live another 30 years. How long has she got? What will her future be like? It's not only on birthdays that she asks herself these questions in the diaries, which are her memory books, her books of her present moment, and her meditations on time. In the earlier diaries of her 20s and 30s, she often manages her overwhelming sense of mortality by imagining her older self reading her earlier diaries. What will the older Virginia think of the younger, she wonders. So in the example I'm going to read, she's 37, 20th of April, 1919. I am trying to tell whichever self it is that reads this hereafter that I can write very much better and take no time over this and forbid her to let the eye of man behold it. A few weeks before that entry, coming up to her 37th birthday in January 1919, she dwells on this fantasy of her future self reading her younger self. It's partly consoling and it's partly alarming. This is the next quote on the sheet. Monday, 20th of January, 1919. So she's 37. If she's about to be, if Virginia Woolf at the age of 50, when she sits down to build her memoirs out of these books, is unable to make a phrase as it should be made, I can only condole with her and remind her of the existence of this fireplace where she has my leave to burn these pages. But how I envy her the task I am preparing for her. There is none I should like better. Already my 37th birthday next Saturday is robbed of some of its terrors by the thought, partly for the benefit of this elderly lady. No subterfuge will then be possible. 50 is elderly, though I anticipate her protest and agree that it is not old. Partly to give the year a solid foundation, I intend to spend the evenings of this week in making out an account of my friendships. The lady of 50 will be able to say how near the truth I come. And she does, indeed, in her 50s, return to her early diaries, looking back, for instance, at the Richmond diaries of the war, when she's writing the war scenes in the years and wants to remind herself of the atmosphere, and is touched to the heart by them. The last quote on your sheet, Sunday, 17th of December, 1933. To freshen my memory of the war, I read some old diaries. How close the tears come, again and again, as I read of Elle and me at the Green, our quarrels, how he crept into my bed with a little purse, and so on. The sense of all that floating away forever down the stream, unknown forever. Queer sense of the past swallowing so much of oneself. Why is Virginia Woolf so preoccupied with pinning down the moment with date and season? It's a way of dealing with mortality and aging, acknowledging it, facing up to it. It's a way of structuring her own life. It's a way of remembering the dead, her dead. That's all obvious. But there is also a complicated paradox at work inside Woolf's marking of time. She is a great writer of memory and mortality and time passing, both in her novels and in her private writings. But she also resists that in herself. She wants quite as much to concentrate not on the past and the future, but on the present moment. Those famous and valiant gestures of bravado with which she often concludes her markings of time are a form of resistance. Take, for instance, her remarks to herself around her 40th birthday. Life consists of how many months? That's what I begin to say to myself as I near my 40th birthday, she writes on Sunday, 22nd of January, 1922. A few weeks later, on Friday, 17th of February, now age 40, she notes that her women friends, all of her women friends who are 40 or over, tend to sit with their backs to the light. She has taken it into her head, she says, after noting this, that I won't live till 70. But in the same breath, she says, I meant to write about death, only life came breaking in as usual. Opting for life, for the interest of the present moment, refusing to be bowed down by the passage of time, is a gesture she often makes in the diary when she comes to the year's end and is summing up her life, making an account of what she has done. Summing up, so important too in the novels. Let me sum up, says Bernard at the end of the waves, is an activity that can hold the passage of time at bay. Sunday, 31st of December, 1932. If one does not lie back and sum up and say to the moment, this very moment, stay, you are so fair, what will be one's gain, dying? No, stay this moment. No one ever says that enough. Always hurry. I am going in now to see L and say, stay this moment. And another of these characteristic entries is made on 19th of July, 1925, when she is 43. Sunday, 19th of July, 1925. But I don't think of the future or the past. I feast on the moment. This is the secret of happiness, but only reached now in middle age. It is the date of Stella Duckworth's death, 28 years before, on the 19th of July, 1897. Stella, who died at 28 and never reached middle age. Woolf doesn't mention it, but perhaps, like all her anniversaries, it is in her mind, even while she tries not to think of the past and to feast on the present moment. But enough of death. It's life that matters. Thank you.
Yes, we will be taking questions now, if that's all right. And please, can you use the microphone if you have a question to ask?
Make sure it's on.
No one has a question. I've got a question, which I would love you to answer, if anyone. Can anyone think of another writer or artistic person, musician, painter, who keeps on doing this, keeps on annotating their past, the specific days in their life, making a big thing out of dates? Don't have to answer it now, but if anyone can think of that, please see me afterwards. That's a question. There. The question does not have to be about the lecture, by the way.
Actually, my answer is, I am answering now, just a little instance, because it might be interesting. Schoenberg, when he was starting to set the poems of Otto Erich Hartleben to music to create Piero Lunaire, wrote down, I started work on the poems today, the 12th of March, 1912. And it was 80 years before my son's birthday, so I clocked it.
That's very interesting, actually, and because that makes me realise that there's another aspect to this that I didn't deal with, didn't think of dealing with, which is the way in which she notes the progress of the work. So she'll say, I've been doing this for 2 years, or I've got another 6 weeks to finish this, or I must turn these proofs around, even though they're making me feel ill with horror, as it were, in a month's time. So that, but that maybe is a more, that may be a more sort of usual, I guess we all do that. That's timetabling, isn't it? Sort of anxiety about, am I going to get finished in time? But marking the day that you begin a piece of work is an interesting one, because it suggests that you know that it's going to be important.
Exactly, and yeah. I think it was an important time in Schoenberg's life, yes. So it helped him out of a depression, which, of course, is something that dogged Virginia Woolf, so maybe it's depressive writers we need to look
well,
at.
Well, certainly with... certainly with Dodgson, Lewis Carroll, it's very interesting. I mean, I love that thing about, you know, I mark this day with a white stone, which he takes from Roman habits, because in Rome you would have a big... You know this, you would have a pot, and at the end of each day you'd either put a white stone or a black stone in the pot, depending on what kind of day it had been. And then at the end of the month you would look and see what kind of a month it had been by saying, you know, was it all... So he said, you know, I mark this day with a white stone. And Dodgson, of course, is a deeply depressive character. Yeah. Yes, there's a question here.
It was just a word that you use, which is accounting, and I think, you know, the idea of the black stone and the white stone, and the idea of diaries being an account, and that sense that she's always worried about counting and counting money, and worried about Leslie counting, and that sense that it is, it's a, almost a sense of ordering. Hesitate to use the word therapeutic, but that idea of sort of controlling, you know, the idea of what's the pattern behind the cotton wool. I'm sure that a lot of this is to do with that sense of trying to get order.
Trying to get control. I mean, as you probably know if you've read my biography, I try to resist a sort of psychoanalytical model about her, because I think there might be other ways of thinking about it, but I'm sure that there may be many other examples of people who try to do that in order to control depression. Yeah. Quite clearly you can see her battling in these times. Yeah. But I'm terribly interested in this idea of accounting. Yeah. If you think of the diaries as an account of accounts book, and if you think also, as you rightly said there, that, you know, one of the horrors of childhood was those terrible days after Julia had died, when every Wednesday Stella and then Vanessa and she had to present the account books to Leslie, and he would bury his head in his hands and say, you're ruining me, why is there so much expenditure on cakes or whatever it was, and, you know, and everything was ruin, and he was bullying them. It was a form of bullying, and she would stand there silently seething with rage, and it created her whole political agenda, actually, those Wednesday afternoons with the account books. And so to turn the diaries into a form of accounting is her way of taking control. She's also very interested in actual sums of money. She's very pleased when she gets her first check for writing a review for the TLS. She loves to add up what she's got. She loves to find that the years or Orlando has been a financial success. She's always worrying, rather like Leslie, about the bill for the greenhouse or whatever. So that kind of accounting is also very important. But I'm very interested in the way it links to the novels, because so often in the novels, Bernard in the Waves is the most obvious example, perhaps, is, okay, what does my life add up to, literally? What account can I make of my life? How can I sum it up? I mean, my favourite, and to me the most moving image of this, is in Mrs. Dalloway, where Clarissa imagines... her parents, her dead parents, at the end of a sort of long avenue, which is rather like that, you know, I will turn up August 1890, you know. And she imagines walking towards them, holding her life in her hands, like obviously like a child. and then reaching them and putting it down and saying, this is what I have made of it, this. Mm-hmm. And it's a most extraordinary image. And I think it's deeply true to what happens when you are living your life and your parents or parent have died, and you have a reckoning in your mind, always, I think. What would you have thought of this? You know, this is what I could have brought to you and say, this is what I've made of it. I mean, I find that very moving. And it is a form of accounting. Yeah, thanks.
And the other word, which is journal, this idea of the day book and the idea of the day being something on the side of life rather than the side of death, that you're making an account of something that has been accomplished rather than something that's lost.
Yeah, sure.
I was interested in her silences in the diary, often when she's mentally ill. Does she sort of say how much time was lost through illness? Or?
Yeah, it's a very good point. And, of course, there's a whole huge chunk of time after the breakdown in 1912 when she's not writing at all. She's not writing diaries and she's not writing anything else. And then when she comes back in the 1915 diaries, it's like notes, little notes, as if she's practicing to walk again. Tiny little notes about things she's seen and the downs and so on. She will quite often talk about time in relation to diary writing. She will say, it's a scandal that I haven't kept this for a week because we've been running around seeing too many people. She will sometimes, I love this bit, she will say, I'm writing this at the wrong time of day. You know, I'm supposed to be writing this after tea and I'm writing it in the morning. And then, you know, I really shouldn't be doing this, you know. And she also literally, you can see the clock at her elbow, she will sometimes say, I've got 3 minutes before I got to go into dinner. I'm writing this, and this is what we did. Right, dinner. You know, so she's rushing something. You can actually see her rushing sometimes in the diary. But that's a very good question, I think, that relationship between actual what she says about her time in terms of writing the diary. Yeah, it's a very good point.
And actually writing her novels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a wonder that one. Yeah.
Right, just take one back and come back. Whose hand was up?
I don't know if he records anniversaries much, but Dr. Johnson always goes into anguish, depressive self-reproach on his birthdays and talks about how, you know, he tries to account for the last year in which he's done so little or his whole life in which he's done so little.
Very good analogy. Thank you. Very good analogy. Yeah, time for a couple more, or even a few more. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. Fantastic lecture. Thank you very much. I just wondered if there's any sense at all, anywhere really, either in the novels or in the diaries or the letters, of Virginia's own sense of her time as a woman, biologically, not having children, as Vanessa has the children. Is there ever any private reflection on that aspect of time? Very, very personal, obviously.
Yes. Lots, actually. Yes, lots about, when I say lots, quite a lot about comparing her, particularly in terms of comparing herself to Vanessa. Not so much, you know, oh, I didn't have children and Vanessa did. I mean, you very occasionally get a touch of that, but it's almost as if she's sort of a bit frightened of even writing that down. Little bits about time of life, not an enormous amount, but a bit, enough to see that that's going on. But a lot about, in comparison with herself and the kind of life that Vanessa is leading and what it is to lead a life with children as compared with a life without. There's a wonderful diary entry on the day that Angelica goes to school. So Angelica is the youngest of the of Vanessa's children, is the last one to go to school. And Virginia writes a whole single diary entry about this, imagining what it would be like to be her sister on the day that the last of the children has left the house, and she imagines Vanessa going back to her studio and, as it were, picking up the life she had before this long stretch of time of bringing up children, and thinking that this is not an emotion she, Virginia, will ever have. And it's the most remarkable, as so often, piece of extraordinary empathy with the other person. I'm sorry I can't remember the date of it, but it would be very easy to find because the diaries are so well indexed by Olivia. But of course it's also about herself. So in writing deeply about Vanessa and imagining that, she's also thinking, well, my life is not like that. Yeah. Yes.
A quote from your book, Violet Dickinson having sent her a present, which was a cradle, in the early days of her marriage. And she says, my baby will sleep in that cradle.
Yes.
And I think that's one of the most telling and moving moments in a lot of her writing.
Did you hear that?
Tells you an awful lot about her as a young woman.
Yeah.
She just thought she was going to have children and didn't. And we know that it was a joint decision of Dr. Leonard and Vanessa and Adrian. I think you say in your biography that she agreed.
Who's to say, you know, that she shouldn't have had children? I mean, looking back on it now, it's a very difficult point, very interesting issue, isn't it? Because there was such a narrative of heritability and you know, her generation, her father's generation, were so influenced by theories of scientists such as Galton about the terrible danger of inheriting mental illness and mental condition. That was clearly one of the arguments. The other being, she couldn't have handled it. You know, she wouldn't have been able to be a mother. And it does seem as if that decision was sort of made around her rather than by her. But, you know, one looks back on the story, there are so many alternative possibilities, aren't there? What would that life have been like if she had had children? Who's to say she couldn't have handled that? You know, what would she have done with her life if she hadn't killed herself at the age of 59? One can't. These are idle questions, but one can't help oneself asking them at times. Yeah. One more question? Anyone want to? Yep.
I think it was the French philosopher Henri Bergson who wrote in the 19th century, end of the 19th century, wrote about time and duration time and chronological time.
La durée.
And duration time was the kind of the key moment that you would remember in your life, some event or like a 50th birthday or something. And Virginia Woolf was interested in those theories, wasn't she? Can you say anything about it?
Yes. It's a moot point as to whether she actually read Bergson, just as it's a moot point to me as to whether she actually read G.E. Moore. You know, I think she sort of, I mean, it's not that she didn't read, you know, she read more than anyone I can think of. Whether she actually read Bergson, I don't know, because she never makes any notes on him, and she never makes any sort of specific allusion to him. Correct me if I'm wrong. But clearly what she's doing with time, like a number of other modernist writers, such as Joyce or Eliot in their different ways, has very much to do with this, and Proust too, with this idea that we don't only live in one time. I think we're very used to this concept now, and I think quantum physics has made us ever more used to it. But the idea that there could be sort of parallel universes going on in our lives at the same time. So we are, you know, we are sitting here at 3:04 on a Saturday afternoon, and this is happening now. But within this room, there are probably, particularly because this talk has been partly about memory and time and death, I'm sure that there have been thoughts going on, or maybe even passing memories going on while I've been talking, which have nothing to do with it being 3:03, as it now is, on a Saturday afternoon in January. So that idea of parallel time or flexi time is something that is very much a characteristic of modernist writing, as we now call it, but also very much in her armoury as well. Yeah, I think it's one of her main subjects and strategies as well. Time is up. Great. Thank you very much.